الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور ثم الذين كفروا بربهم يعدلون الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا الحمد لله الذي له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وله الحمد في الآخرة وهو الحكيم الخبير الحمد لله فاطر السماوات والأرض جاعل الملائكة رسلاً أولي أجنحة مثنى وثلاث ورباع يزيد في الخلق ما يشاء إن الله على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا وقائدنا ومرشدنا وحجتنا وشفيعنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله وطاعته وأحثكم على التمسك بهدي قرآنه وسنة نبيه فقد قال الله جل من قائل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما صدق الله العظيم. My dear brothers, sisters, dearest children, in the Quran, in Surah Ibrahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us something related to Prophet Musa that is of great significance in the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Surah Ibrahim, talking about Musa, very closely related to something about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And before I quote this ayah, I thought that we would appreciate how the Quran functions. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings history into perspective. And what we benefit from one prophet and messenger can be of great significance in the lives of people who are drawing their values from the message sent to the final prophet and messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولقد أرسلنا موسى بآياتنا أن أخرج قومك من الظلمات إلى النور وذكرهم بأيام الله إن في ذلك لآيات لكل صبار شكور not آية لآيات لكل صبار, not صابر, صبار, not شاكر, شكور. And the Quran, even every letter has its own significance. So let us start enjoying what this ayah is all about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayah number 5 of Surah Ibrahim, talking about Musa, tells us that in the life of Bani Israel, there were great difficulties. They faced one disaster after the other. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted Musa to go and deliver Bani Israel from their difficulties to a kind of life that is in reconciliation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from difficulty to ease. So how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advise Musa to do it? He said, we have sent Musa bi ayatina. We gave him the instructions, we told him what to do, and we told him that he should go and deliver his people, Bani Israel, from darkness into light. Please keep this, ظلمات إلى النور, because we will find this repeated many a time in relation to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The same thing, deliver your people from the darkness to the light. How would you do that? And this is, as they say in Arabic, baytul qasid. This is the secret code that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Musa alayhi salam to help him to deliver Bani Israel from great difficulties, from the darkness into the light. How would he do that? He said, remind them of the days of Allah. وَذَكِّرُهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ. What are the days of Allah? Give me just a few moments and I will inshallah expand on أيام الله. But I would like to just make short comment on the ending. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِكُلِّ صَبَّارٍ شَكُورٍ. Verily, those who would understand why the secret code of أيام الله, they will find that there are signs for him or her who is always perseverant, always patient, does not break down in the face of first difficulty. No, he is sabbar all the time, shakur, always thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever happens. Now, what are the days of Allah? The days of Allah, our scholars told us, are the days wherein things happen that any person cannot help but get connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are occasions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala implanted into days of the week, days of the month, days of the year, days overall, to keep us connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as such, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them Ayyamullah. These are the days of Allah. And there are many of them. Now, let me just draw the comparison between أخرج قومك من الظلمات إلى النور. Brothers and sisters, we know today is the first Friday of 2016, and before anyone say this is not our year, it is our year. Yes, there is a Hijri year, and there's this year that we follow. All the days are the days of Allah. But let us now try to draw the comparison that we are facing great difficulties everywhere. We sometimes stop and say, what shall we do? What happened to the image of our deen in the eyes of people who do not know enough about Islam? Why is it that people now are looking at us and they are not very comfortable? Why is it that someone now on hashtag would say, I used to love White Oaks Mall, but not anymore because it's full of Muslims? Allahu Akbar. Now someone found it suitable to write that I don't like White Oak Small anymore. Why? Because now it's full of Muslims. Does that tell us something? We are facing a great challenge of identity with our children. Our children are now listening. They are watching. They are seeing. Is this the Islam that when I was small, you wanted me to follow? And now is this what is happening? Now we are finding that the greatest refugee wave of all time is the refugee wave of our brothers and sisters from Syria. We know that the injustices committed against our brothers, the Palestinians, are, you know, history cannot find anything equal, except in Myanmar, it's all involving Muslims. So what is happening? These are Khutbah. But we don't want to stay in the darkness. We would like to be delivered from the ghulumat to the nur. And you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed Ahl al-Kitab, the people of the book, the Christians and the Jews. And he told them in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولُنَا يُبَيِّنُ لَكُمْ كَثِيرًا مِمَّا تُخْفُونَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَيَعْفُو عَنْ كَثِيرٍ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ يَهْدِي بِهِ اللَّهُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ رِضْوَانَهُ سُبُلَ السَّلَامِ وَيُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَيَهْدِيهِمْ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Christians and the Jews. Let us come together. You are one family. And now, the final messenger from the same God, from Allah. Allah is the Arabic for God. And by the way, I'm mentioning this, not that I think you don't know that, but there are people with us today who are not Muslim, and I know that, I was told. And I'm explaining that it's the same God of Jews and Christians and Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists. It's the same God, one God. In Arabic, it's Allah. In French, it's Dieu. Now this God sent messages with Abraham, with Moses, with Jesus, with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And now when the final message came with Muhammad, the Almighty God said that Muhammad has the message to deliver people from the darkness to the light with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what we have to recognize. Now, back to Ayyamullah so that we don't get confused. I want to bring now Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the picture and say that what I read in Surah Ibrahim about Zulumat ila al-Nur, what Musa did, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he has to do the same thing. All prophets and messengers have to bring us from the darkness to the light. Allahu waliyu alladhina aman yukhrijuhum min al-Zulumat ila al-Nur. This is what the challenge is all about. People keep pushing to the darkness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants them to be taken from the darkness to the light. And it continues throughout history. People go back to the darkness, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He loves us, He sends those who will take our hands and pull us back to the light. And this is what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is doing now. How did Musa do it? By reminding Bani Israel of the days of Allah. How would Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam do it? By reminding us of the days of Allah. Now this is something here that I would like to explain now. Al-Isra al-Mi'raj is a day of Allah. Laylat al-Qadr is a day of Allah. The beginning of Ramadan is a day of Allah. The 10th of Muharram is a day of Allah. The day of Arafat is a day of Allah. The birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a day of Allah. Oops! Don't get to this now because it's No. It is a day of Allah. You know why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who will deliver humanity for the last time from the darkness to the light. And this is the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now wouldn't you think that to be pulled out for the last time, this is your last chance, from the darkness to the light, isn't this a favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Isn't this a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Quran to this man called Muhammad ibn Abdullah, Muhammad the son of Abdullah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Yunus, Ya ayyuha al-nas, فَجَاءَكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ قُلْ يَا مُحَمَّدُ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that in Surah Yunus, He has sent us a book that is a cause of healing to that which is in the chests of people. It is a source of guidance. It is a source of mercy. This is the Quran. And then he says, because of the favor, because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have a cause to rejoice. And now, look at this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made certain that the days of Allah are not fixed in time. Now, we were told that Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj is on the 27th of Rajab. I don't want to confuse anybody, but there is no confirmation that it is on the 27th of Rajab. Now, Laylatul Qadr, we were told probably it is on the 27th of Ramadan, but we know that it could be on any other night. We know that we were told that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was born on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. But we know that this is not the case. That it is in Rabi' al-Awwal, but when we don't know. We know that to determine the first day of Ramadan, sometimes we hit it, sometimes we miss it. But we fast when the Ummah agrees. And we go into Eid al-Fitr, a day of Allah, by looking into the crescent of Shawwal. We may hit, we may miss, we don't know. Why is that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us that it is not the date that really matters, it is the occasion that matters. So when we say ayyamullah, we are not talking about the dates of Allah. We are talking about the occasions of Allah. So it doesn't matter to talk about the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam right on the 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal, or to rejoice on the occasion of Isra and Mi'raj on the 27th of Rajab, or to talk about sacrifice of Ibrahim for his son Ismail right on the day of Adha. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Dhakkirhum," remind them. Keep reminding them. I could very well talk today about Isra and Mi'raj. Who would stop me? Not because I have the minbar, I mean that. No. I mean that I could justify talking about that because it is a day of Allah. And that is why some will say it is not the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal anymore. But I say I would like to talk about my prophet, my beloved, my mentor, my messenger, my teacher, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was the key that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to humanity to deliver us from the difficulties of darkness to the ease of light. And this is the only way that is left for us, brothers and sisters. You want to solve the problems of the world, it is the Quran and the Sunnah. I would like now to share with you something I mentioned a few weeks back at the London Muslim Mosque. I would like to share it. Some who were there might have heard it, but I would like to mention it again. Imagine, and this is, kids, in high school, in public school, they get assignments. Now I would like to present you with an assignment right now. Imagine I give you now a list of 20 pre-weighed objects. I have weighed them exactly, and I put object number one as the weight as such, two such, three this, four this, and I keep this list, and I give you the objects with numbers, and I say, this is, you know, your package of 20 objects, and I want you to weigh them. So you go, it's an assignment, and you bring the scale you want, and you weigh them, and then you write the weights, and you give me the list, and I compare. I know I have the exact weights. I worked on it hard, and if I find one mistake, two mistakes, I say this is human, we all make mistakes. But if every weight is wrong, I say, wait a minute. There's one of two possibilities only. There's no third possibility. One possibility is that the scale you used is faulty. It doesn't work. That's why you produce every weight wrong. The other possibility, to which there's no third, is that you don't know how to use the scale. You don't know how to weigh. Can you think of another possibility? There isn't. Either the scale doesn't work or you don't know how to use the scale. Now let us look at the world today. Nothing's working. The environment is collapsing. Until finally in Paris, 130 countries said, well, you know, we can't, we are suffocating unless we do this. We don't know if they will do it. But at least they said we will do something. Because the earth is dying. Now look at the violent climate phenomena. Never before did we hear about such floods, such phenomena that are all over the world. That's the earth. Wars all over. Justice is only to be written about in something called, you know, the Declaration of Human Rights. Now we talk about it, but it is not to be applied in Palestine or in Myanmar or in other parts of the world. It's very selective. We know that some people's lives are not as important as other lives. We know that. There are refugees now moving all over the world. We know, as we said, oops, it is a little bit too cold today. We know that there are children who are barefoot, who are walking in that slush around their tents, and the tents are leaking. We know that this has happened. We know that Muslims are unable to agree among each other about how to go back to the Islam of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not only go back in political scene only. Imagine every year we talk about moon sighting, but we shouldn't call it moon sighting. We should call it moon fighting. We fight over the new crescent. Muslims continue to think that unless we go to one extreme, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not approve of our actions. Now there is a wave that should scare all of us. That our youth are finding that the answer is taking an extreme stand. And this is a major challenge that we are facing. Since when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his way to deliver us from the darkness to the light, told us, unless you go all the way to this side, you will perish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at this, لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. Why was this mentioned when God said in Surah Al-Baqarah, and as such we made you a nation of the middle path, so that other nations would use you as an example, as witnesses over how humanity should live. Today, we are described by anything but balanced. Anything but balanced. The balance that we were supposed to follow is gone. We don't know how to weigh anymore. We don't know how to use the scale anymore. We lost that ability to weigh. About extremism, look at this right at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that you will not say I'm using an example which is far separated from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the messenger of God. You all heard of Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam complaining about a person. You know who he was complaining about to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He was complaining about his own son, Abdullah. And we all heard the ahadith that Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As related. Most notably that hadith of if'al wala haraj in Mina related to Hajj. Now, what did Amr ibn al-As say to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Said, Ya Rasulullah, I can't keep up with my son. He's taking it way too extreme. He is up every single night. He is fasting every single day. He is so, at the time Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, please help me, I can't. Now what did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say to him? He said, leave him, he said, no, Abdullah, come here. Why are you doing this? You shouldn't be doing that. Islam is a practical way of life that you should live comfortably and you should allow your body to catch up a little bit so that you will enjoy life at ease. Don't take things to the extreme. Nowadays, unfortunately, there are many of our youth who think that this is the... And guess what? They think that the extreme of Islam, now, the extreme of academic excellence is when you have somebody that we call a nerd, or we call, you know, somebody who is doesn't talk to others, he's always with his books or her books, and is always at the library, and he's saying things to the extreme of academic excellence, and is getting honors in every subject, and is getting hundreds, and extreme. And some may say, well, good for him or her. Good. She is doing wonderful. But look at the disaster that we have today. That they think that the extreme of Islam is to go and kill any non-Muslim, is to go and scare people, is to go and frown in other people's faces, is to say that it is haram to say happy holidays to non-Muslims. It is... Who told you that this is the extreme of Islam? You know what's the extreme of Islam? The extreme of Islam is to love your enemy. The extreme of Islam is to love the people who hate you. The extreme of Islam is to forgive others who have wronged you big time. The extreme of Islam is to preserve blood relationships despite the fact that the rest of your family has wronged you. The extreme of Islam is to go and share with others, outreach, do things that, you know, it was an extreme display of Islam out of Calgary on Christmas Day when it was snowing very hard in Calgary. And a group of Muslims went to their neighbors, lots of them, and they started to shovel the snow for them. To me, that was extremism. But it is extremism in the proper direction. extremism of love, extremism of outreach. This is what we should, but to say this is extremist attitude by killing others, by scaring others, by not talking. It's as if extremism in academic excellence is not to care whether you get a 0 or you get a 50, or this is extremism. But this is not Islam. This is not Islam. Islam, we want it back. And that's why today I want my message to the children, to the youth. I want you to say, no, we want to show people what Islam is all about. I want you to think of acts of kindness. This is my assignment number 2 to all of the children. Please do that. And you may ask help from your parents. Call your friends, say, what shall we do? Make a list of acts of kindness you want to do and share with your non-Muslim friends. And I'll tell you why in the second khutbah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فيا فوز المستغفرين. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will accept our dua. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومواله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Dear children, sisters, brothers, early in the history of Islam, the companions of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, noticed that he was fasting on a Monday. They came to him and they said, why are you fasting on Mondays? We've noticed that every Monday you are fasting. Every Monday you are fasting. What did he say to them? He said, ذَلِكَ يَوْمٌ وُلِدْتُ فِيهِ. He said, Monday is a day wherein I was born. Now, let us not philosophize what is really very simple. He said, I'm recognizing that Allah, and this is, by the way, Monday is established. Now, which Monday of Rabi'ul Awwal, we don't know. But we know that Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was born on a Monday. And by the way, he died on a Monday as well. He said, I am fasting because Allah brought me to this life on a Monday. Now what do we learn from this? What do we learn from this? We learn that the way that Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was celebrating the mission of deliverance from light, from darkness to light, from darkness to light, he was celebrating that by the act of fasting. That was a celebration. But the problem we are facing today is linguistic. We use words and we get stuck to words. They say, no, haram to do ihtifal bil mawlid al-nabawi al-sharif. Now, ihtifal, who said that this celebration we are talking about is to bring a cake and blow candles? And by the way, whether you will get upset with me or not, there's absolutely nothing wrong, because this is a cultural practice. People do lots of things, by the way. You know, in Beirut, in Lebanon, where I was born, I remember when it would be Eid al-Mawlid al-Nabawi, that there will be a place where they have a big fire, and then they will have fireworks, and this is the culture. To say that this is how we are rejoicing. قل بفضل الله وبرحمته فبذلك فليفرحوا. Why do we want to deny people the opportunity to get happy? Why? You know, many, many people get happy when they fast on a Monday and Thursday. They feel happy. You know, who said that our celebration is to go and start dancing in a Darvishi style? Who said that? You know what? Wallahi, we are wasting lots of our energy. Lots of our energy by, you know, no, you're wrong. You're not right. You're this. You know what? I say it very simply. Take it easy. Take it easy. Let us go back to the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to deal with his companions. And that is why we have to go back and get trained on how we are going to use the mizan called the Quran and the Sunnah. I want to remind us of what is called Arus al-Quran. You know Arus al-Quran is Surah al-Rahman. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Ma'alish, please bear with me. Okay, I won't take long, just 2 more hours. Inshallah. Now, in Surah al-Rahman, no, I'm just kidding for those who are here for the first time. Inshallah, it won't be long. And some people would say it's haram to make people smile or, you know, during Khutbah al-Jum'ah. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I can tell you that at times he said things that made people smile during his khutbah. But this is one example how we lost our ability to use the mizan, the sunnah of Rasul. We don't know. We simply do not know. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, Ar-Rahman, Allam al-Qur'an, خلق الإنسان علمه البيان الشمس والقمر بحسبان والنجم والشجر يسجدان والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان ووضع الميزان ألا تطغوا في الميزان ألا تطغوا. Now lots of طغيان in the ميزان. Lots of ألا تطغوا في الميزان وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, be careful. Allah gave you the balance so that you will do things in balance. Now some people say, but this is about fakiha and rumman and produce and vegetables and no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not talking about the mizan of produce. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the mizan of everything we do in our lives. It has to be in balance. Don't go to this extreme or that extreme. Let us now learn how to be people that others would come and congregate around. Now, what do I advise about acts of kindness that we really need to go out? You know what? I may not think of what the youngest here may think of. He may say, I would like to go and buy 12 roses, give 6 to the neighbors on this side, and 6 to the neighbors on that side, and tell them Happy New Year. Yes, read my lips. I'm saying Happy New Year, because we are living in a country, in a world. There's nothing wrong because today is the 1st of January. Let me challenge the majority among us. What's the Islamic date today? The majority do not know. When we should know, let us have some balance. Let us know the Hijri and let us know the Miladi. You know something? We know. Let us share with our friends in a nice way that Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, was not born on the 25th of December. And they know that. The majority don't know that, but the leaders of the Christian community know that he was not born on the 25th of December. That's why the Orthodox Church, they celebrated on the 8th of January. He wasn't born on the 8th either. We know that historically he was born in summer, most probably in the month of August. And what does that mean? It means that we have lots of opportunity to just show goodwill, give them a rose, and say Happy New Year from your neighbors, the Fayyads, the Hassans, the Bians, the, you know, the, whatever. Just go and, you know what? Go and shovel snow. You know of some elderly couple, go and shovel the snow of their driveway, and then go and knock on their door after you do it. Not before, after. And you say, so that you don't get startled, I wanted to let you know that I shoveled the snow to wish you Happy New Year. You know, try, if you are wearing the hijab, sister, daughter, you know, go and go with your son or daughter and knock at the door, because they will know that you are a Muslim. Because we are proud of our daughters, our sisters, our mothers, our wives, who are carrying their identity card with them wherever they go. So make sure that if you do that, you represent Islam properly. You know, I heard something that made my heart bleed yesterday. You know, a group of, I won't identify which country, a group of Muslim business people, a group of Muslim business people went to China to buy something, to bring it to their country to sell. Now, their host, the one who is selling them, you know, received them, and they said to him, you know, please, we would like to make sure that the meat you give to us is slaughtered in a certain way called the halal way, because we cannot eat any other way. He said, okay, what do you do? And he went and he did it exactly what they asked for. And then after they ate, when it was time to do business, they said, we would like you to put a label on the product that says made in Germany. They bought it from China. And they said, we would like you to put on it a label saying made in Germany. He said, what kind of religion is this, where you care a lot about how your chicken or your beef is slaughtered, and you don't care about the ethics, the morality, made in Germany when it is made in China? Islam does not teach us. You want to be extreme, okay? Then you say made in China means made in China. Let us show the world. You know, I gave just a couple of examples about acts of kindness. Sisters, make sure, and I say to you, because you go to Walmart, you go to, you know, and again, you know, white oaks, I want to say, Ma'lish, some may be sitting right here, I won't say it. You know, I would say spade is a spade. Ma'lish. I was walking one time with my son going to buy something from White Oaks. And I saw a few Muslims. I don't know if they saw me, but I saw them. Where were they sitting? They were sitting facing Victoria's Secret. And they were talking in Arabic. Malish, you would say you shouldn't have said that. No, I would say it. Because we want to represent our deen properly. You are here today for Salatul Jumu'ah. I hope, inshallah, when Asr comes, you will pray Asr as well, and Maghrib and Isha. And in between, you will conduct yourself according to the mizan. To the mizan. Because this is our Islam. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وخطايانا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم علمنا من ديننا ما جهلنا وذكرنا منه ما نسينا وكن معنا ولا تكن علينا. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر. الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا